make a big job and organize this conference, school conference. And I understand what it was not easy, but they do that. Thank you very much. Ladies and gentlemen, I would like to... So it also some tutorial lecture. I will refer to some old results and even very old results. Old now means 20th century, but the latest appearance here will be from 19th century. And I will speak about nonlinear spin dynamics for antiferromagnets. For antiferromagnets, that means what I think what many people know what is how it looks like for ferromagnets, but here I will discuss antiferromagnets. Why antiferromagnets? Antiferromagnets is of course much more young domain of physics of magnets compared with ferromagnets, because ferromagnets were referred even in some ancient literature. And antiferromagnets, this concept appeared in the 30s of the past century. But now many people are looking for antiferromagnets more and more closely, because there is some interesting points and some interesting physical properties of these materials. First of all, I would say, being honest, I wrote this slide maybe 10 years ago approximately, or 11 years ago, or 12. And some points, first of all, this one, and this one is old. And this is my outlook, and here I will, so we will see. I will not discuss outlook now, I will go back. So again, this is old slide, and here I would like to discuss some motivation, why antiferromagnets is so interesting now. First of all, again, it was present many years ago. And that time people discuss antiferromagnets as from two points of view. First of all, of some non-trivial system which have some strong coupling of optical field, some light with antiferromagnets, magnetoelastic coupling in antiferromagnets, and this is interesting system from this viewpoint. Some of antiferromagnets are completely transparent. You can read newspaper from the plate of iron borate as thick as my finger. You can easily read newspaper from it. And also the most important point and most interesting point here is what the natural frequencies of the antiferromagnetic resonance is approximately one or two order of magnitude higher than for ferromagnets. And also, I would say, what now the interest for antiferromagnets appear much more because of some application in spintronics. And our conference, our school conference, will demonstrate that, because it will be a lot of talks concerning this kind of application. So now, again, it's a tutorial lecture. So let me present some here's from textbooks. This is ferromagnet. This is the simplest case for ferromagnet. You have some chain of spin, say here for this field. And the spins are subject of some exchange interaction. And because of this exchange interaction, they are paired. This is antiferromagnet, again the simplest model. And for this simplest model, you have alternative. The sign of exchange interaction is different. So the neighboring spins prefer to be antiparallel. And for this reason, I can say what these antiferromagnets can be considered as two ferromagnets which are bring together. So two sublattices, two ferromagnets, and so on. But if this picture is more or less adequate, this picture is more. Discussion of antiferromagnets is more complete. also as one more example from the textbooks, this is ferry magnets. Ferry magnets are different from eddy ferromagnets by the following way. In some lattices, you have a different atoms. Different atoms means what they can be different in any sense of physical properties. And concerning antiferromagnets, it is very important to say this is called naive state. It is important to say what for the difference between antiferromagnets and ferry magnets is as the following. It should be some element of the crystal group which replaces sublattices. It is just the definition of antiferromagnets. Anything else is not antiferromagnets. It can be ferry magnet. For example, for some ferry magnets, it is possible to find compensation point. Compensation point means what for this temperature, say, magnetization of sublattices is exactly equal. Is it antiferromagnet? It's not antiferromagnet. It's ferry. And because, first of all, because of the following, you have two kinds of compensation. It can be compensation of the magnetic moment and can be compensation of mean value of spins. And the physical properties for this compensation are completely different. Antiferromagnet have to say, have to have this at least one odd element which replaces sublattices. And this difference of the magnetization for sublattices, so-called negative, change the sign after that. Magnetization for antiferromagnet, yeah, I can also introduce it. And sometimes it is even non-zero in the ground state of the system, even in the absence of the magnetic field. So I cannot say what antiferromagnet is something which has zero magnetization. Sometimes it has non-zero magnetization. But the important point is what this odd element is present. And it can replace sublattices, and for this reason, it changes the sign of the snare field. In the brilliant lecture of Dr. Song, it was mentioned what magnetization can contribute to some Berry curvature, to some interesting properties, to some anomalous Hall effect, and so on and so on. And the point is, and what about this? Well, for ferromagnet, I have magnetization. Magnetization changed its sign after the time reversal. But here, additionally to time reversal, I have one more element which changes the sign of the element, of the nail bed. Well, let's go ahead. So the first part of my talk is finished. So let's discuss the statics of any ferromagnet accommodating this property of compensation. So let's discuss how to magnetize antiferromagnet. Let me have some sublattices. Again, this is Snell vector. This is magnetization. This is saturation magnetization. And in principle, this is some quantum Hamiltonian or semi-classical quantum, but written through spins. And one can easily see what kind I can rewrite it through the total magnetization of the system with use of this constraint. And also I have some Zeeman energy, so-called Zeeman energy, because this is total magnetic field. Of course, magnetic field is not acting on the nail. And this is total magnetic field. Let me introduce this total magnetic field, which is first of all external magnetic field, and then so-called Zelashinsky field. And then it will be so-called inverse Faraday field and something else and something else. All these effective fields are contribute to this story. And some behavior will be very common, so I can introduce this total magnetic field. What about the Zelashinsky field? This is so-called internal magnetic field. And it appears because of the following. Some antiferromagnet allow this strange invariance, which contains L linear, which are linear in magnetization, linear in nail vector, and also contain some vector D. So this term is Zelashinsky. You can ask me why it can be present if I can change the sign of the alien. The point is what kind of odd element I am having. If this is odd translation, no chance. This German is completely fixed. For nickel oxide, which is very popular in Europe, the term is completely empty. If it is also odd inversion, it's also completely. If it's some other axis, we have to see. At least this is, for some interferon magnets, like ortoferrites, it is present, and it's produced also, as well as the, its action is the same as the action of the external field, but in the so, here I introduce exchange field. It is the natural definition of exchange field is as the following. If I apply external field and I am looking for content of the interferomagnetic lattice, finally I will want saturated value of the magnetic field. This is the, this I call exchange field. I stress attention on that because in some articles, some old articles, the exchange field was defined in a different way with multiplier 1/2 or 2 and so on, and for this reason it would be some, if you are working with concrete system, concrete experiments and so on, you have to watch what kind of definition of exchange field people are using. So, and then our point is as the following. We have magnetization, you have total magnetic field. This term is quadratic over the magnetization. This is linear. But the exchange field is a huge value. It's a huge field. The typical unit is megahertz. Or some megatesla sometimes. Because it is connected directly to the exchange interaction. For ferromagnet, you will never have that. For interferon, it's present in the Hamiltonian, in the macroscopic condition. And how it is working? If you will make, if you will make some minimization of this energy over the magnetic moment, and you use this constraint, what the magnetization should be orthogonal to the name vector, you will easily find the difference. So what happens if I apply strong magnetic field? Does not matter if it's external field or some kind of Zelashinsky field and so on. First of all, if I apply it along the easy axis, nothing happens sometimes. Because to have magnetization, you have to have some content. But the easy axis perverts this content. So for some values of the magnetic field, it will be no content, no magnetic moment, and so on. And then you will see this spin flow transition, and you will see the sublattices content and some magnetic moment. And from this picture, it is easy to see what this value of the magnetic field is, not anisotropy field. It's something like square root from the anisotropy field and exchange. And this is the first example of the exchange enhancement of some antiferromagnetic parameters. For ferromagnet, if you have easy axis, you can easily define what is anisotropy. Let's apply the field perpendicular to easy axis. Magnetic moments start to rotate. Then it will be, for some value of the field, it will be parallel to the external field. Okay, this is anisotropic. But here, it's not easy to define again. And here, the typical value is not anisotropy axis, anisotropy field, excuse me, but square root from exchange field and anisotropy. For this reason, this is some much more big value for orientation of spin than in ferro. Let's discuss Zelashinsky. Here I use the simplest model of this Zelashinsky field of this kind. And again, you see what here should be some d, some direction which is determined by the symmetry of the crystal. And if this vector D is parallel, let now we discuss some simplest uniaxial, completely uniaxial model. You have some principal axis, and you have some, and vector D obviously is parallel to this principal axis. For this reason, you can see what it's possible to have two possibilities. Magnetization should be either along the z-axis, and in this case, it will be no magnetic moment. Or it can be perpendicular to the chosen axis. It will be hard axis in that case. They can lie in the easy plane. And in that case, you will have some time. And what is interesting, what we can, rule with this presence or absence of the weak magnetic moment, because some materials have some reorientation transitions with the change on the sign of the anisotropy constant, hematite, dysprosium orthoferrite, and some other, have some Morin transition, the transition from the collinear, exactly collinear antiferromagnet with zero magnetization to counter antiferromagnet. Here I present some just to show you what it can be present. For some orthoferrite, which has the formula of this kind, and R is some radio of iron, and for them, for high temperature, you forever have the same phase. The phase where the L vector is directed along A, and the magnetization along C axis. In physical orthoferrite, people prefer these notations. And then you have some different phase transitions, for example. And this, with the, if the temperature going to low temperature, rare earths start to work. They change the anisotropy. And finally, we'll get either another counter antiferromagnetic phase, or even not magnetic phase, which is going on. So this is statics, it's interesting. Let's discuss the interest. Here I had mentioned what the sigma model versus Landau-Lipschitz is something like Newton dynamic versus Aristotelian. Let me explain my words. What is Landau-Lipschitz equation for ferromagnet? It's first order equation. If it is first order equation, formally, we have to introduce initial deviation of the magnetization. Well, this is Aristotle dynamic, because you don't need to have coordinate its speed, velocity. Coordinated velocity. So this is first order equation. And for this equation, let me remind what is this dynamics of the magnetization for ferromagnet. It's just precession. From this equation, you can easily see what this is precession around the effective field, which can be again external field, anisotropy field, and something else. And this is more or less universal. This is some coefficient, gyro magnetic ratio, which is 2.8 gigahertz to kilohertz. So to have 30 gigahertz, you have to have 10 kilohertz. 30 gigahertz. It's 1 centimeter, it's okay. This system are very useful for microwave technique in centimeter range. But to have millimeter, you have applied a stronger field. And this is not so easy. And you can see here what the gap in the magnet spectrum is determined completely by external field or anisotropy field. Use this simple equation. And exchange field, sometimes introduced by the are present only to this dispersion term. So it is not connected directly to exchange interaction. It's connected, of course, but it cannot be measured directly. And it is obvious what this kind of equation is forbidden for anything. As I told you before, for antiferromagnet, the main variable is nail vector, and monetization, some kind of slavery. But you cannot write down this. Here everything is okay. Because magnetic field, magnetization, DVT. So time reversal is the symmetry element of this equation. And time reversal is the symmetry element for this wrong equation. But also we have some odd element. And what we can do? We should to consider the sigma model was derived by many people in a different way, classically, quantum, and so on. And so we can start from the two equations for Landau-Lipschitz equation for magnetization, sublattice magnetizations. Then we can combine them in the equation for sum and difference. And then look what we can do with that. So I have to mention what here you have. In principle, you have spin transfer term, which can be, of course, present in any of Landau-Lipschitz equation here, it also appears here. Then, again, I will do the same as before. I can say what magnetization is small. And finally, I arrive from magnetization is small, this is equation. And finally, I arrive to this equation, simple one, where you have total magnetic moment, so the same as was before, and plus some dynamical charge. And I can present magnetization through a vector and its time derivative. Then I can take that and put it in the second equation. And I will put sigma model. Which is present here. Here, for simplicity, I remove the magnetic field. And also I remove the Leschinsky field. Why I am doing that? Because their role is very special, and I prefer to discuss it in the last part of my talk. And this is sigma model equation for the simplest case, where you have no external or the Leschinsky magnetic. So I can say for some kind of Leschinsky interaction is still to be the same. And this is the equation for magnetization through the equator. So if we will find the solution of this equation, we can find the magnetization. There is no dynamics of nail vector, which is not producer the magnetization. So what we can see from this equation? First of all, here, naturally, exchange field appear in the denominator. It's present here. I will take the time derivative. I have second time derivative of the air vector and exchange field here. So this is omega squared. If I'm discussing, say, normal modes, it's omega squared. This is anisotropy. This is something else, Gilbert dynamic, spin torque, and so on. But omega squared will be again anisotropy field multiplied by exchange. And for the, and this is the explanation why natural frequencies of antiferromagnetic resonance appear to be in terahertz instead of dozens of gigahertz. Exchange field is very high. First of second, instead of Aristotle dynamic, you first time. First order time derivative, you have second order time derivative. So you have inertial techniques. And this is very interesting. And also what I can add to that is what you can see from here. You have second time derivative here, and you have gradient squared here. And the combination can be present in this way. This is Lorentz invariant combination. This Lorentz invariant combination, where C is just a parameter of the antiferromagnet. It is not speed of light. It's some velocity, say, some phase velocity of antiferromagnetic magnets. And again, it is enhanced by exchange interaction. And for this reason, C is of order of 10 kilometers per second. For different interferometers. So this is enhancement. This is enhancement as well for the velocity. And this is Lorentz invariance, and this is inertia. So then I said what I wanted to discuss: nonlinear dynamics. First of all, the simplest nonlinear dynamics is some non-uniform from oscillation of the Neil vector, some non-uniform oscillation of the Neil vector. And again, let's start with the case that the magnetic field is absent. For this case, if you have uniform oscillation, you can then present your Lagrangian in this form with some effective mass. You have kinetic energy. And the constraint was the L vector is fixed by itself. Then the better solution is to consider as some motion of the massive particle on a sphere instead of precession. We have massive particle with some mass which is moving along the sphere. And in general, you have some kinetic energy, you have some potential energy. And the point is, can I solve this problem? For Fermat, it's very easy. Because for Fermat, you have 1 degree of freedom. You can say what I have momentum, and I have, this is typical, I say T, it's better to say G, kinetic term in Fall-Landau Lipschitz equation. And you have one coordinate phi, and one cosine phi will be momentum. Here I have 2 degrees. Fortunately, the most general case of 2 biaxial antiferromagnets, biaxial potential, and moving on the sphere, along the sphere, was considered by Carl Neumann, a brilliant mathematician, of 19th century. He found and he showed what this problem is integral. So additionally to the energy, we have one more integral of motion. So we can solve this. The point is why we have solved it. Why it is interesting. It's some old problem. Because what is nonlinear dynamic of monetization? One of kinds of nonlinear dynamics is the orientation of the monetization, up to down. This is what we need to have if we are looking for some fast element for magnetic memory and so on. So let's discuss what can be done for ultra-fast spin reorientation with use of this or that mechanism. And in the beginning of our century, it was recognized what inverse Faraday effect, which was created by Pitayevsky in the 60s, inverse Faraday effect. And recently I learned what Faraday tried to find inverse. He found directly rotation of the plane of magnetization in the media place to the magnetic. And in his laboratory books, he wrote what he is trying to find inversely, but he was not able. And now it can be realized with some lasers, and you can see how appears this inverse rotation. If we have some circular polarization, this term is non-zero. And it changed the sign under the time inverse. For this reason, this term is invariant. And for this reason, if you have a circular polarized light, you have some effective magnetic field. Some magnetic field of inverse Faraday. So we can do the following. If we have some, say, 100 femtosecond or 40 femtosecond laser pulse, we can use it as some pump sending into the sound. And if this pump is circularly polarized, I can create a pulse of the magnetic field on my sound. And this is very, say, strong field. And also, I can use the same pulse with some delay drive as a probe. And then you can see what you put your pump after few picosecond on even few hundred or femtosecond, you will get probe light which will look what happened with the sample. So for this reason, you can easily learn what happens in the system with very high frequency. And also now more sophisticated ways are used, for example, X-ray magneto optics and tyrogates magneto optics, but I have no time to discuss it. And what we can do with this very powerful tool for ferromagnet? Can we rotate the magnetic moment of ferromagnet? The answer is no. Answer is no. Even for high magnetic field, like 20 kilohertz in the pulse, and for some materials, even 40, 50 kilohertz in this short pulse, even in that case, you can see that if you rotate magnetic moment of ferromagnet during the X-ray of the pulse, you have to have strong field and long pulse. And the estimate shows that there is no way to turn the magnetic moment from up to down. For anti-ferromagnet, the situation is more easy. You have some inertia. You can kick your particle atmosphere and it starts to move. And that's what is realized by Niemeyer and Hu. They do that firstly in 2004. And they, and here is nice picture. You can see what they have two different circular polarizations. Act, this pulse is acting on octaferrite. And you can see what excite oscillation. And you can see this is 15 picosecond. And in the first work it was just linear effect, but then it was possible to realize non-linear effect and even switching of the magnetic. This is the action of the pulse. Then, independently of the chirality of the circular polarized light, you have either switch to up state or down state. And you can see what the energy, this is just inertial thing. Because the pulse is very short. And after the action of the pulse, you have some motion of the nail. And this is, that time it was the fastest switching of the magnetic during 5 years. And come to the next non-uniform magnetic. So we discuss here uniform case, uniform space case for the signal model equation. And now let's discuss what happened in non-uniform case and what interesting can be present. And mostly here I will discuss dynamics of the solitons and vortices. And then the next will be break. So everything what I say, all of what I said about Lorentz invariant dynamics will be broken, or could be broken in the next. So non-uniform dynamics. This is Lagrangian. You can see what this here naturally, this Lorentz invariant combination here. And this is standard Lagrangian for the Lorentz invariant field theory. Sigma model just appeared first as some model equation in the field theory. Then it was applied for initial slip. We can calculate the field momentum using this Lagrangian density of the field momentum from the standard equation from the textbooks. And the integral of this field momentum will be total momentum of our excitation. I am wrote here soliton because I will discuss mostly soliton excitation. And here you can see what the sigma model equation is very easy and nice. Because if I know the static solution of any kind, of any soliton, domain wall, or vortex, or skirmion, soliton of any kind. If I know the static solution, and standardly it is the case, but I can find the static solution. If I know the static solution, I can immediately apply Lorentz transformations, and I will get dynamic solutions, which describe the motion of the soliton with some constant velocity. Lorentz transformation means what I have, again, here I automatically have some limit velocity for any soliton, and this limit velocity is nothing but the velocity of magnons, and also it can found, it is tens of kilometers per second, and also I can calculate the momentum, and I can even write down it without any calculation, because all equations could be the same, should be the same as is in some relativistic mechanics for particles. And so then it's more easy, much more easy to find the moving solutions. Much more easy than for Ferropa. And it was used for description of the experiments. I would say what our motivation with working with anti-Ferromagnon, my personal motivation, was this experiments which has been done in the 70s. It was done in Moscow State University. They do two things. They had good samples with some chemical polishing of the surface and so on. They have very good samples of ortoferrite and iron. And they use the samples, and they investigate the motion of the domain wall under the action of the external field. And they found this difference. This is some simple theory, theoretical data, which can be found from the sigma model equation with inclusion of Gilbert damping. And the only fitted parameter here is this mobility, which is instead of Gilbert damping constant. And this is the theory, this is the experiment. We have some saturation here. It should be for relativistic particles under an action of the external field. It's also interesting things here. You have some anomalies near the sound velocity. This domain wall should go in with the velocity like 15 kilometers per second. It should overcome the sound barrier. And this is two anomalies here. It is from the room temperature. It's transversal and longitudinal sound, 4.2 kilometers per second and 6 kilometers per second. And if you are working with low temperatures, low temperatures, this anomaly becomes much more complicated and strong. And also some interesting effects here appear here, but I have no time to discuss this. And also, for this is, it was a nice experiment. Unfortunately, for some other magnetic, anti-ferromagnetic solitons, like anti-ferromagnetic droplet solitons or anti-ferromagnetic vortices, which we discussed in some articles, unfortunately, there is no experiments yet, but I hope it will be. And the same regulation is here. You have Lorentz invariant dynamics, and it can be easily described. I would say what the dynamics of ferromagnetic vortices with non-small velocity, it's still a problem now. So it's not discussed. There is no theory which describes the motion of ferromagnetic vortices with arbitrary velocity. For anti-ferromagnets, everything. The point how to create anti-ferromagnetic vortices. That is. And then the last part of the talk, I use Lorentz invariants here. But the point is what I would like to stress again. What Lorentz invariants appear for the sigma model only in the case if you have no magnetic field, or the Leschinsky field, or something like this. So what happened if I apply magnetic field? If I apply magnetic field, the only Newtonian Lagrangian is present here. Again, you can easily see what this term can be found not only after the calculation, what I showed before, these two sublattices, two set of Landau-Lefschetz equations, and so on, I also can write down this term with use just of symmetry, some symmetry consideration. If I have everything, the only thing what I have to have should be quadratic over A. And also I have the field time reversal discovered by this time reversal, L squared, so what is it? So everything. And the role of different kind of magnetic is very first of all, the main simplest version of the Leschinsky, I would say what now, in I never saw discussion, now many people are working with antiferromagnet because of this ultra-fast spin dynamics under the pulse action, because of this spin transfer activity which is started and very developing very fast. And I never saw what somebody discuss some other terms, other forms of the Leschinsky. People call, let me say a few words, people call the Leschinsky model. But it was a completely different article, writing down in the interval of few years. The Leschinsky had considered this kind of terms to explain the experiment where people saw this kind in the ground state of magnetic. Moria derived some kind of this term. We use some for the pair of spins. We were counting for exchange interaction and spinometer interaction. And in the article of Moria, it was called antisymmetric exchange. Antisymmetric. And it have only this form. But for different antiferromagnet, some Dzelashinsky have shown before, but it could be some other forms. For ortoferrites, people use this notation. But in principle, you have D1 and D3 here. At room temperature, the difference is small. But say for nitrogen, for some ortoferrites, the ratio of these two constants can be 3, 4, 5, and so on. There's a big difference. So this is the simplest form, but not the only one. For manganese fluoride, it's also interesting antiferromagnet, which is discussed. Well, okay, it's interesting antiferromagnet. For manganese fluoride, this term is forbidden. Instead, you have some. And so on. Some other different terms can be present as well. For example, they could be linear in magnetization, but cubic for the nail. Some other things can be present. And this simplest form, and this which is exchange relativistic, produce more break of the symmetry of the Lagrangian. This is total time derivative. And total time derivative which is not topologically protected. It is not the case with Fermi. But other terms can produce some break of the Lorentz invariance even in the absence of the external external field usually breaks the Lorentz invariance. But let me discuss everything. So probably not any talk can be present without modern theoretical talk cannot be present without this term, with very phase and so on and so on. And for ferromagnet, the dynamical term which describes the dynamics of ferromagnet has this form, can be present in this way. And this A field is formally equivalent to the field of the Dirac model as well. What for interferon? And this B field for Fermat have the finite flux to all the surfaces. And this B field for ferromagnet and for every field, of course, is responsible for many things. For example, you know what form 1D ferromagnetic solutions, so-called Walker solution, you have periodic dispersion annihilation for the solitons in continuous movement. Everybody knows again what gyroforce for 2D solitons, for vortices or skirmishes, is present. And all these terms are the same. They are, say, inspired by this wave phase, by this B field, and so on, and so on. By the flux of the field. For antiferromagnet, I also can present this term, which breaks the Lorentz invariance, as some effective antiferromagnetic. A vector, vector potential, and B vector, but it's possible to show for all the Zelazny-Wohr interaction which can be present, as well as for magnetic field, this flux is zero. So this is no Dirac monopole. It can be writing down some general equation, some general property common to Dirac monopole. It's proportional, it's parallel to A vector. But here you have some different pictures. For example, if you have, it's easy to see, but if you have magnetic field, this is just magnetic field, external magnetic field multiplied scalarly by A. For some different kind of Zelazny-Wohr interaction, you have something more complicated. How it is working? First of all, the action of this effective field, of this Bayes phrase, and so on, can be present, say, for dynamics of 1D solid, as well as here for ferromagnets. It was considered many years ago, and we made some classification of this 1D solitons, and found what sometimes Lorentz invariance is broken, sometimes it's still to be. So it's an important point which can be considered. Moreover, I would say that sometimes this break of Lorentz invariance is not formal, because for very small velocities compared with the C, you have some destruction of the solution. So limit velocity can be much less than C. For example, for this Mann-Minnis fluoride. And also it was reviewed in our review article evaluation. Of course, it's working only for this non-trivial Zelazny movement. Also, 1D, here I spoke about solitons, but this is one more object, instantons, which are common to solitons, but instead of soliton, 1D soliton domain will coordinate X, for instanton, you have your coordinate, effective coordinate, is imaginary time. And for instantons, it's also interesting to see for ferromagnets. For example, for ferromagnets, there is some kind of contribution of the wave phase, this kind, which produce destructive interference. It's one domain wall can be considered as some domain wall alone. But instantons, you are looking for some different instanton passes for tunneling. And for ferromagnet, it can be shown what typical picture for, say, non-integer spin is destructive interference of instanton trajectories. They just kill each other and no tunneling is present. For anti-ferromagnet, situation is more rich. For example, you also can find some destructive interference. But it's rare. Normally, all of this, if I consider all the trajectories, no destructive interference is possible. And concerning antiferromagnetic forces, in the next one. As I told you, If you have ferromagnetic vortex, you have a gyro force. If you have anti-ferromagnetic vortex without magnetic, you have Lorentz invariant dynamics. If you have anti-ferromagnetic vortex in the external magnetic, you also consider that. If you have in the external magnetic field, gyro force is have the same symptom. There's some coefficient. And you can see, first of all, it's small. It's the ratio of external field to electric field. But even being a small, it can be interesting. And also, it does not depend on the polarization of the vortices. Many people now are working with the vortices, and they say that the gyro force is determined by the polarization of the vortices. Not the case for interferometry. For both possible polarization of the course of anti-ferromagnetic vortices, you have the same value of gyro force. And what one more interesting, for ferromagnetic vortices, you have this 4 pi total flux. So if you consider the vortex, which is just mapping of the magnetic moment or A vector for half of sphere, upper or lower, you have one value of gyro force, and for skirmion you have twice more gyro force. Because this 4 pi is just Dirac monopole. For antiferromagnet, it is not the case. And you have a very interesting situation, which was again not far. What if you have a vortex, you have gyro force, but if you have skirmion, so full mapping of the sphere, you have no gyro. So it's much more, this gyro effects in antiferromagnet is more tiny and much less universal. Thank you.
Boris, you told us that the Alofinsky field is very huge, about 100 tesla. Yeah. And my question is, what is the real intrinsic parameter responsible for generation of such strong?
The Alofinsky field. Yes. I cannot say it's huge. Exchange field. But the Alofinsky field for some materials is like 100 kiloersted, 200 and so on. Exchange field is megahertz, or tens of megahertz. But Dzerzhinsky field, formally, roughly speaking, is the square root from relativistic and exchange field. As well as usual spin flop field, what I say. Because it's the origin of this interaction was found by Moore. And he found what it is exchange and the spin loop. So square root from Coulomb field and spin loop. For this reason, it's not so huge as Coulomb interaction or exchange field, but also for water ferrites is 160 kilohertz. It cannot be created by standard laboratory electromagnets.
So I didn't quite follow. In order to have a domain wall, usually I think that you need to have anisotropy. Right. And then isn't that going to break your Lorentz invariance? I mean, you were talking about domain walls moving as examples of things that could move and still preserve. You wanted that to describe that with a Lorentz invariant equations, and I wasn't quite sure how you get the stable domain wall in the first place.
Sure, but I understand. But I will try to answer. Well, your question, you said what the domain wall should be. To have domain wall, you have to have anisotropy. That's correct. But in isotropy, you do not break Lorentz invariants. Any kind of invariant. Let me go a little bit back and show you. Well, there's enough to show this. This is an isotropy.
W.
Yep. Here it is an exterior, but I had no time. This is an isotropy. This is external. And this is dynamical. Oh, for any anisotropy, for any kind of distribution, for everything, I will have all these invariants. Magnetic field here is just a driving field. It can be high enough, a few hundred volts, but it's very small value. It should be just, how to say, work against dimming. But it's also stationary.
Does first properties of antiparameters survive the suddenly being in the paper?
That's a very good question. In some degree. In which degree it can be interesting? First, if you have some compensation, near the compensation, and compensation of what? Magnetization or spin. Near the point of compensation of angular momentum of ions, you have some property common to antiferron. One of these properties is very fast dynamics of soliton, high velocities, and high frequencies, exchange in the square root from extinction in this. But it is known only near the small, in the vicinity of this transition. It's the ratio of exchange field to an anisotropy to exchange. Inside this narrow region, you have the same high frequency oscillations. If you are going far from it, you have one relativistic and one exchange. Exchange is not under consideration. Some other properties, presence of Zelashinsky, Mori, and so on and so on, is completely absent for any compensation and so on, not in compensation, far from compensation. And even Lorentz invariance is a little bit broken there. But I have no time to discuss it.
Can I ask a quick question? So just to clarify, you have restricted your attention to insulating
yes.
materials. What about the metals? Like, what do you think, what would you say are the most prominent, some relevant effects when you...
Thank you. Thank you. Well, thank you for this question. It's really a good question. Because now, I have to say it in the beginning, but now let me say it. For me, Landau-Lipschitz equation, everybody knows what Landau-Lipschitz equation can be applied for either for insulators or for metals. The question is why? If you can derive a Landau-Lipschitz equation for insulator, but for metals it's some other. And I would like to stress, this is what I say in the question. I would like to stress that if you are working with antiferromagnet, this Landau-Lipschitz equation is simplification, but it's the simplest universal equation for magnetization. Sigma model equation is of course simplification, but this minimal universal equation for antiferromagnet. This is what I would say.
What do you think are the effects beyond the sigma model that some most interesting for metals?
I don't think so.
You think that's something interesting?
I don't think so. For metals, well, it's another good question, because I would say what in some simplification, in some approximation, I can also, for example, take the equation for easy plane ferromagnet and present it in the form of some pendulum, which has been done by Hans Jorgen. But the applicability of this approximation is very bad, because here this equation can be applied till the values of the frequencies and external fields and so on, till exchange. You will never see this exchange moves. And everything which is below exchange is okay. It's the simplest. What can be beyond sigma model?
But maybe in terms of transport, for example, just magnetic resistance or some kind of anomalous transport from the electron side of you.
Well, it cannot be described for underlifts as well. You have to consider some
concept beyond, like anomalous Hall effect of ferromagnets, for example.
It can be found. It can be found.
Anything and associated with the nail order? Any transport anomalies for the nail order?
Let me answer. I said about, say, inverse Faraday, which is connected to magnetization. But also, it is known, it was found experimentally. In the 70s, what the Faraday effect can be present through anything, for some antiferromagnets. If you have Faraday effect, of course you will have anomalous Hall effect and everything and everything. And I can explain it. It looks like some mystics, but it is not the case. But because if you have some invariant like the Leshinsky Moria, which is connected some component of magnetization with component of Elliott. Of course you will have it.
Is it Erdős matter? Like anomalous Hall effect relating to the L lecture.
It is possible to show what this is some of diagonal Hall tensor terms proportional to the name.
Experimentally.
Concerning experiments, I cannot say any details. But the same for Faraday effect. It was found for many interferomagnets, including the Zotto Ferrari. And what is connected to the metals, like chromium, with spin density, it's a good question. But I think what it can be done also.
Any other questions?
As I understand, all additional terms which you have in your Lagrangian, they should satisfy symmetrical properties of crystal which you are
interested.
So, if we evaluate the symmetry of crystal, just applying strain or something, can we get some new interesting phenomena in this case, or it's beyond the scope?
Good question. Yes, of course. Yes, of course. The point is what is the amplitude of the strain and so on. Yes.
And
also, you have, it's well known, effects now, if you have some magnet connected to the heavy metal with strong spin orbit interaction, you can break the inversion. And also, it's possible to get some new contributions in the Leshinsky Moria from there. And some other, yes, of course, if you lower in the symmetry, you will get something new.
And second, maybe not a very serious question, what is the time of humans? So you told in the end of your talk that the all the new is the form in the end of your talk.
So what do you say?
You told that all new stuff which people know, it's
what
old.
So I made some references. I made some references. And the references are from, say, 70s. This is 2000, 95, this is 80s, and at what concerning the well forgotten, and this is 16, this is the new result. And what is new is well forgotten old? In some articles which are dealing with this anti-ferromagnetic spin torque and so on. People derive Sigma model again and again. And also they derive it in linear. Maybe it's enough linear. But I would say what Sigma model is non-linear in its origin. And this is, it is much more general, I would like to stress, than the deviation from the sublattice model and so on. And concerning you as well, forgotten all? Yes, it was some gap between, for example, theoretical investigation of the solitons in ferromagnet and in anti-ferromagnet and their observation. No deep sense.
But of course, experimentally, yeah, there's a renewed interest in anti-ferromagnets experimentally these days that is driving also the theory interest, and it turns out that theory is far ahead of experiments, but now people care much more about this theory in the context of experiments.
It doesn't seem to you, but I would say, Yaroslav said what is some renewed interest, but it appeared twice. First after this femtosecond experience, and now with this spin torque and so on.
Yeah.
And I believe what this anti-ferromagnet is very important for you.
These days we're having conferences dedicated just to anti-ferromagnets. So a few conferences every year, just anti-ferromagnets, spintronics dynamics, everything. I guess it's probably as much interest as has ever been, and more. So, if there are no other questions, let's close the morning session. Let's thank Boris.